Hello. I hope you're all keeping well in these difficult times. Welcome to Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 season of online talks. My name is Cyril Pearce. I would like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Barbara Smith. Dr. Smith is a retired university lecturer with a background in mathematics and computer programming, but she is also an active member of the Knitting and Crochet Guild. And it's that connection which is the subject of her talk today. Many of the older people watching this will remember a time, not that long ago, I comfort myself by thinking, when knitting, sewing, and needlework were familiar parts of family life. Hand-knitted sweaters and scarves, even hats, dresses, cardigans, and the like, embroidered tablecloths and pillowcases with and without decorative crochet. It was a worldwide phenomenon, and a Huddersfield firm, Wakefield and Greenwood, were at the centre of it for almost 50 years with their wools for the world. Dr. Smith.
Hello, and welcome to this talk on a Huddersfield business, Wakefield, Greenwood and Company, which sold wools and other yarns for hand knitting from premises in Railway Street. Its trademark incorporated the slogan "Wools for the World." So that explains my title. The talk is based on research that I started doing through working on publications in the collection of the Knitting and Crochet Guild. I'm going to start by saying a little bit about the Guild. It was founded in 1978 to support the crafts of hand knitting, domestic machine knitting, and crochet. It's a UK-based organisation, though it does have some overseas members as well. It has about 40 branches around the country, including one in Huddersfield, which in normal times meets monthly in the town hall. The Guild maintains a very large collection of all kinds of material relating to knitting and crochet in this country. The collection is kept in Slathwaite in a converted mill building, and we believe it is the largest collection of its kind in the UK. We don't have any exhibition space at Slathwaite, but we do try to make the collection as accessible as possible, for instance, by hosting group visits in Slathwaite, again, in normal times, or by taking selections of items to groups elsewhere. We've also very recently had a project supported by the Heritage Fund, which put 100 objects from the collection on the Guild website. And the 100 objects page on the website is a very good place to start if you'd like to know the kind of thing that's in the collection. The Guild and its collection are entirely run by volunteers, including me. I work on the publications in the collection, which include books, magazines, booklets of patterns for knitting and crochet, and pattern leaflets issued by spinners and other suppliers of knitting yarn. There are over 50,000 of those pattern leaflets. Again, that aspect of the collection, we believe, is by far the largest in the country. Not long after I started working on the Guild collection, I found a box of pattern leaflets that had been issued by Wakefield, Greenwood and Company. The top picture on this slide shows the back, is from the back of one of the leaflets. I hadn't heard of Wakefield, Greenwood until that point. And the address on Railway Street, Huddersfield, caught my eye because I live in Huddersfield too. I'd also seen adverts in various knitting magazines from the 1930s and 1940s for a Greenwoods shop in Victoria Street in Huddersfield, which sold knitting wools and other handicraft materials. So, of course, I wondered if there was a connection between Greenwood's shop in Huddersfield and the Wakefield Greenwood Company in Huddersfield. And more investigation showed that they were indeed connected. The shop came first, and then quite a bit later, Wakefield Greenwood and Company was set up as a separate business. Both businesses were set up by two people, Clara Greenwood and Harold Wakefield, who were married to each other. The rest of this talk will be the story of their careers. Harold and Clara were both born in 1898, and in the 1911 census, when they were 12, they were both living in Mould Green in Huddersfield with their families. The next thing I know about them is that Harold joined the army in 1916. His occupation then was clerk, and he was possibly a clerk for most of his time in the army, because when he was demobilised late in 1919, his specialist military qualification was given as clerk. The next part of the story that I know about comes from Clara Greenwood herself. When she retired in the 1960s, she was interviewed by the Huddersfield Examiner. And in that interview, she said that she and Harold, who was then her fiancé, had opened the shop, Greenwood's, in 1919. When he was fresh from army service. I don't know what the impetus was for starting a wool shop at that point, but possibly Clara had worked in a wool shop after leaving school. I don't know whether that's true, it's a pure guess, but it does seem extraordinarily reckless for the pair of them to have opened a wool shop if neither of them had had any shop experience at all. The original Greenwood shop was at number 13 Victoria Street. The whole street has now disappeared under the later development around the piazza, but I've added it to a modern map here to show where it was. I've also marked the Lawrence Battley Theatre, which is the nearest surviving landmark. Of course, originally it was the Queen Street Methodist Chapel. The blue rectangle on the south side of Victoria Street marks the position of numbers 13, 15 and 17, because eventually the shop spread into all three of those. The shop was listed in the 1927 Kelly's Directory under fancy repositories. A fancy repository sold knitting wools and other needlecraft materials, such as embroidery threads and fabrics, and buttons, pins, needles, and so on, and possibly other handicraft materials as well, depending on the shop. In 1927, there were four other fancy repositories in Huddersfield Town Centre, including two in the Market Hall, which I've marked. And as I said, I wonder if Clara had actually worked in one of those shops after leaving school. Harold and Clara were married in 1920, but the shop continued to be known as Greenwoods. And in 1927, the owner of the shop was named in the Kelly's Directory as Miss Clara Greenwood. So I wonder if Mr. and Mrs. Wakefield felt that it would be more acceptable if the owner of a wool shop was nominally a woman. Their daughter Margaret was born in 1921. And so I think that the first few years of running the shop must have been very hard work. But they seem to have succeeded quite quickly, because by 1927, they'd already expanded into number 15. This photo of Greenwood's shop was taken in the early 1950s, when they had further expanded into number 17. So you have to imagine that in 1919, the shop only occupied a third of this frontage. At some point, they also opened shops in Queen Street and Cross Church Street, selling haberdashery, hosiery, corsetry, and I think children's clothes. In preparing this talk, I would have liked to check up on when these shops opened and what precisely they sold in the Examiner archives, because the shop did regularly advertise in the Examiner. But of course, the local studies library has been closed, so I haven't been able to do that. Through the 1920s, Harold and Clara were evidently establishing and expanding their business in the shop and selling within Huddersfield. Moving into the 1930s, they evidently started to think about expanding sales beyond Huddersfield. In the 1930s, knitting was becoming increasingly popular, along with other handicrafts as well, I believe. One sign of this was the launch of new knitting magazines, including Stitchcraft. This is the first issue from October 1932. It was a monthly magazine owned by Paton's and Baldwin's, which at that time was probably the largest manufacturer of knitting wools in the country. So all the knitting patterns in Stitchcraft specified Paton's and Baldwin's wools. And in fact, the main purpose of the magazine, I think, was to sell Paton's and Baldwin's wools. However, they did also cover embroidery in the magazine, as you can see from the front cover here. So it wasn't all knitting by any means. Harold and Clara evidently saw the new magazine as an opportunity. And only a few months after the first issue of Stitchcraft appeared, Greenwood started to advertise in it. They offered a mail order service to readers, so this was how they were going to expand outside Huddersfield to the rest of the country. As you can see, they claimed a complete selection of everything for making everything out of every number of Stitchcraft. So, also notice that the advert gives prices for what we would now call kits, that is, everything you needed to make something featured in the magazine. So knitting wools, as well as the needles of the right size, or the fabric and the tapestry wool to make an embroidered cushion cover. The small print at the bottom of the ad mentions the offer of a free 56-page catalogue of linens, needlework and handicrafts. So they were really going for mail order in a big way here, and they must have had a huge range of stock to support that kind of offer. Later on, other shops also offered mail order to Stitchcraft readers, but Greenwoods was the first, and I think by several years. And the offer of complete packages of materials was, I think, a novel idea. Another magazine that launched in 1932 was Vogue Knitting Book. This was a spin-off from Vogue magazine. And so, as you would expect, it was full of patterns for fashionable and stylish garments. It was published twice a year, in spring and autumn. And by 1937, Greenwood's was also offering a mail order service to Vogue knitting readers for the yarns featured in the magazine. This was a lot more complicated than supplying Paton's and Baldwin's wools to Stitchcraft readers, because there were many more suppliers involved in Vogue knitting. The reason I'm showing this issue from 1941 is that by this time, Greenwoods had taken the next step in expanding the business, which was selling knitting yarn under their own label. They weren't producing it themselves, of course, but commissioning it from spinners. I think, given what came later, which we shall see in a bit, it was Harold Wakefield himself, not Clara, that was responsible for this move, and he looked after that side of the business. The Greenwoods ad in this issue offers a mail order service for most of the wools featured in the magazine and lists the Greenwoods yarns that were available too. The page numbers alongside Greenwoods Super Fingering Wool and Greenwoods Angora refer to patterns in the magazine which specified those yarns. I should explain here that evidently the way that Vogue Knitting Book worked was that if a yarn company advertised in an issue, there would be at least one pattern in that issue that specified that company's yarn. This was a mutually beneficial arrangement because the magazine got the advertising revenue, of course, and the yarn company had a pattern published with the cachet of Vogue that specified their yarn. And any reader who wanted to knit that garment would buy their yarn. So here Greenwoods were benefiting from that arrangement. They advertised in Vogue Knitting Book, and this issue had three patterns specifying Greenwoods yarn. You can see from this advert that Greenwoods also offered a knitting service, and they would have had a team of outworkers around Huddersfield to do the knitting. Advertising in Vogue Knitting Book must have been financially worthwhile for Greenwoods, because the shop and then later Wakefield, Greenwood and Company advertised in every issue from 1937 to 1962. And we'll see later what happened in 1962. The early 1940s, when this issue appeared, seems an unpropitious time for Greenwoods to have started their own yarn brand. There were shortages of knitting wool throughout the war and afterwards, and knitting wool was covered by clothes rationing from 1941 onwards. Until 1949. But even so, Greenwood's adverts in Vogue Knitting Book offer an increasing range of yarns as time went on. Many of them were made from silk or cotton, which was not rationed, I believe. But it does seem remarkable that the shop should have been able to secure reliable supplies of knitting yarn in wartime. And I think it indicates that by this time, Harold Wakefield must have had very good contacts indeed with spinners. The next step in 1946 was to separate the shop and the yarn business. And this is when Wakefield, Greenwood and Company was set up, with premises in the estate buildings in Railway Street. So finally, Harold Wakefield got his name on the business after more than 25 years. The directors of the new company, of course, were Harold and Clara, but in fact, Harold Wakefield ran the new company and was based at Railway Street, while Clara carried on at the shop. This photo is looking towards St George's Square with the station off to the left. I've ringed the entrance to number 6. It is the right-hand door of the pair. There was a lot more space available here than in the shop. It was over 4 floors plus a cellar. The shop must have been incredibly cramped by this time, I think. Up till now, Greenwood's yarns had mostly been sold by mail order, I think. But Wakefield Greenwood yarns were going to be sold through yarn shops around the country. So this was a major change in how the business operated. If you want a wool shop to sell your yarns, you have to provide patterns as well. Knitters typically would first choose a pattern they liked and then buy the wool to make it. So Wakefield Greenwood needed to produce a range of patterns for all their yarns. This is one of the early ones, number 118. I think the numbering started at 101. Judging by the serial numbers of the pattern leaflets, they eventually published over 500 of them, of which, as I said at the beginning, we have 200 in the Guild collection. Once you're producing pattern leaflets, you can use them in your advertising. Again, the hope is that the design will appeal to knitters and they will go to their local wool shop to buy your yarn. You can see that the advert says, sold by all good wool shops. There's no mention anymore of mail order, except that you could send off for the pattern leaflet by post. I should say, though, that mail order of handicraft supplies, including things like rug kits, was continuing from the shop. I've only talked about Harold and Clara so far, but of course there were many more people involved in the two businesses. This photo is of an outing to Blackpool for the Greenwoods and Wakefield Greenwoods staff in about 1947. It was lent to me by one of the women on the back row who worked in the shop in the 1940s. Harold and Clara are sitting in the middle of the front row, and I've enlarged that part of the photo here. There seem to be a surprising number of people here, considering that the company was not actually manufacturing the yarns it sold. But I think we forget that in pre-computer days, running a business like Wakefield Greenwood must have required a lot of office staff to deal with their various suppliers and with wool shops around the country. In the late 1940s, knitting wool became more plentiful, and Wakefield Greenwood mainly advertised Shetland wool and Botany wool, that is Merino. In the 1950s, the company introduced new yarns, which at that time meant mainly the new synthetics, and the first new introduction was nylon. The Draper's Record, which is a trade magazine, in March 1950, described Wakefield Greenwood as pioneers in the processing of nylon for hand knitting, and said that they were at that time in 1950 marketing a nylon yarn. And the Bradford Observer newspaper said that at the 1950 British News Industries Fair, where Wakefield Greenwood had a stand, 80% of the visitors to the stand were interested in buying their nylon yarn, and it was being rationed to £12 for each buyer. The buyers in that case were buyers for shops rather than individual knitters, of course. So the Draper's Record was wrong because Wakefield Greenwood were not involved in the processing of nylon at all. But even so, it does seem that they were the first company in the UK to make pure nylon knitting yarn available to shops. Wakefield Greenwood didn't actually advertise their nylon yarn, Nylon-S, until 1952, in spite of the fact that they'd been selling it in 1950, if not earlier. Perhaps they didn't need to advertise it, perhaps it sold itself, I don't know. we wouldn't now want to knit with pure nylon because really it's not very nice. So it's interesting to see how it appealed in those days. The advert here lists its advantages compared with wool. It wears very well, it washes easily, it dries very quickly, it's shrink-proof, it's moth-proof. And so knitters were really keen to buy it, evidently. And of course, as I've said before, if you introduce a new knitting yarn, you have to have knitting patterns to go with it. I think the style of these two and the fact that the leaflet is in colour emphasises that nylon-esque was a luxury yarn at that time. The next innovation introduced by Wakefield, Greenwood and Company was merino wool with a metallic thread running through it. Wakefield Greenwood launched this at the British Industries Fair in 1953, and this pattern for springtime botany and tinsel shows that it was intended for elegant evening wear. And very fortunately, we know exactly what this yarn was like. A few years ago, a guild member found several balls of springtime botany and tinsel in a charity shop, and she donated them to the collection. I used two of them to knit this lacy scarf so that we could show what it's like and what it feels like. I used a Wakefield Greenwood pattern leaflet, of course. I hope you can see from the photograph that there are gold sparkles in the black wool. It would make a very nice evening scarf with this really airy, light fabric. Though I have to say that the metallic thread means that it is not actually quite as soft as pure merino would be. Other new Wakefield Greenwood yarns introduced during the 1950s included Turkish mohair, terraline, which was polyester yarn, and Orlon, which was acrylic yarn. They also introduced interesting mixtures like nylon with angora and mohair with tinsel. They carried on selling Shetland wool and botany wool as well. And they also had a cashmere yarn available. Although we don't think of acrylic, polyester and nylon as luxury yarns, they were at that time. And evidently, Wakefield Greenwood were aiming at the quality end of the knitting market. And meanwhile, the shop on Victoria Street was still flourishing. Here are some nice photos of the interior of the shop from the early 1950s from the Kirklees Image Archive. I've looked at these photographs in detail, enlarging them as much as I can, and to see what they were selling. And as you would expect, they were selling Wakefield Greenwood yarns, as well as Patents and Baldwin's wools, which they had been doing since the 1930s, and several other brands as well, like Bairnswear and Emu and several others. Let's return to my title and the Wools for the World slogan. Was the company justified in claiming that? There is some evidence that Wakefield Greenwood did sell their yarns outside the UK, and the most striking evidence is this advert, which shows that in 1949 you could buy Wakefield Greenwood wools in Fiji. Fiji does seem an unlikely place to where anyone would want to buy knitting wool, but if you wanted to, you could. I've also found records of Harold Wakefield travelling to New York in 1947 and to South Africa in 1948, presumably in both cases to sell yarn. And when the botany and tinsel yarn was introduced in 1953, a report on the British Industries Fair and the Wakefield Greenwood stand said that though this new product was introduced only 8 weeks ago, substantial orders have already been received from European countries, South Africa, and Australia. So they were at various times selling in very far-flung places. At the end of the 1950s, Wakefield Greenwood and Company was doing very well, as far as I can tell. They were advertising widely in other knitting magazines, as well as Vogue Knitting Book, and in magazines like Woman's Weekly. They had patterns published in magazines, including Vogue Knitting Book, as I've already described, as well as publishing their own pattern leaflets. The company was certainly doing well enough for a much larger company to buy it in 1958. Brocklehurst Whiston was a silk spinning company based in Macclesfield, and I think they probably supplied silk knitting yarn to Greenwoods back in the 1940s when the shop was selling that yarn under its own brand. By 1958, Brocklehurst Whiston was also producing rayon, nylon, and terraline, and it had mills in Brickhouse. The year after the purchase, the Brocklehurst Whiston chairman's report said that they wanted to strengthen the structure of the company by seeking additional outlets for their products. A new company, WG Spinners, was formed, which was 80% owned by Brocklehurst Whiston, and I assume that the remaining 20% was owned by Mr. and Mrs. Wakefield. Harold Wakefield went on working for the new company, which stayed at Railway Street until 1960 and then moved to Brickhouse. However, the change in ownership didn't go at all well. In 1960, at the Brocklehurst Whiston AGM, the chairman reported that the subsidiary in the hand knitting yarn trade showed an increased loss. I've no idea what the problem was. Perhaps the company wasn't adapting fast enough to changes in what knitters wanted, and perhaps being embedded in a much larger company made adapting difficult. I really don't know. This advert in Vogue Knitting Book in 1962 was the last one, ending the long relationship between Wakefield Vogue Knitting Book and first of all Greenwoods and then Wakefield Greenwood, going back to 1937. And in fact, this is the last advert for WG Spinners that I've been able to find anywhere. I'm sure that Harold Wakefield would not have approved of stopping advertising, because advertising had been the way they expanded their business going right back to the early days. And so a few years later, Harold Wakefield retired, the company closed down, and in 1966, it was formally liquidated. But meanwhile, Clara Wakefield was still running the Greenwood shop, which apparently was still doing well. By this time, though, they were both in their late 60s, and in 1967, Clara decided to retire herself and close the shop. In her retirement interview in The Examiner, she said that their daughter and her family had emigrated to Toronto and they would like to visit them and see their four grandsons. I'll finish by repeating the Wakefield Greenwood trademark with their Wools for the World slogan. I'm really very impressed by what Harold Wakefield and Clara Greenwood achieved, starting from nothing and building up to two successful businesses. They were innovative. They introduced new selling methods to expand their markets. And in the 1950s, they were at the forefront in introducing new knitting yarns. And they certainly did sell wool outside the UK. And if they could sell wool to Fiji, then it seems to me that they could justifiably claim to sell wools for the world. I think a comfortable retirement visiting their grandchildren in Canada would have been very well deserved. Thank you very much for listening.
This talk has been one of Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 programme. We are a membership society and it would be very good if you could come and join us. But if you can't do that, given these difficult COVID times, you can visit our website. There you'll be able to find out what we are, what we do, who we are, and what sort of events and publications we have. Thank you for coming and listening to the talk. We hope to see you again next time. Goodbye for now.